morning, ladies Alfredo dinner tonight at 6 p.m. Grilled chicken and pasta and drinks provided. So see Shannon if you have any questions. Also during the service or shortly after the service, we'll have a quick business meeting this morning to vote on the business for our church constitution. And just one quick reminder, Wednesday night Bible study, 6:30 each Wednesday, and youth ministry, grade 6 to 12, or 9 to 10 Sunday school, and also youth fellowship from 6 to 7:30 every Wednesday. Anita asked me to pass on this morning, the youth Sunday school group made these compassion bags. They have just some essential items in there. Feel free to grab one or two when you leave this morning. Be a good thing to give to the homeless or people who are struggling really down on their luck. But it's really got some essential stuff in there. It'd be good for them. That's probably better than giving them money.
Yeah.
So if you would bow with me, I'll pray for us. We'll start our service. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the day and the blessings you've given us, Lord. We're just thankful for the opportunity we have to gather and worship in your house. Lord, we ask that you be with those that are ill, those that are traveling, those that couldn't be with us this morning. Lord, we just ask that you watch over them, protect them, and bring them back to us safely. Lord, we ask that you, you open our hearts this morning and let us apply Randy's message to our daily lives. And Lord, we just ask that you be with those men and women in uniform protecting our freedoms to allow us together like this. Lord, just be with us this morning and watch over us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you would stand as we sing this morning.
Yeah, you'll have a seat. Good to see everybody. Glad y'all could make it today. No snow. So we missed last Sunday, and hopefully that won't happen again this winter, but anything's possible. So if you have a question about whether we're going to have services or not on Sunday morning, Dolores sends out an email alert as early as possible on Sunday. And so if she doesn't have your email address, you might give that to her today, and then she can put it in her records and make sure you get notified. And I'll also try to text everybody. I haven't phoned them before, but anyway, I'm sorry we missed last Sunday. I'm glad you're all here today. Good to see everybody. We have a couple of new folks visiting today. On the back row there is Tony and Barbara. And so when we shake hands here in a moment, be sure to greet them. It's good to have you guys with us today. Now, I want to take just a couple of minutes here and go ahead and discuss our business with our Constitution. We talked about this about a year ago, that whenever we began as a new church, we would revise our Constitution. And this is from Paramount, what they had, and worked with us on. And so they had a church council in there, so we discussed removing the church council responsibilities and letting either the church handle that, or me or the deacons, depending on what the situation may be. And so y'all through the Constitution, revised all that. It's been out on the table now for the last 30 days as required. And so we need to vote on that this morning just to approve the new Constitution. So does anybody have a question at all? Anything at all about the Constitution?
Yeah.
Okay. I was just going to mention, it does call just for one constitutional committee. That's the Finance Committee. We do have a Finance Committee. That's Patty Jones and Chris Froman and Amy Reed. Audience told me. And so that's a constitutional committee. But we can form committees anytime we want to, that are not constitutional. Like, we have a youth committee right now. And so we may have others that come along as needed. And so we can do that. That prohibits us from doing that. Any questions at all? I know we discussed this before. I discussed this with our deacons, and they're all on board with it. So this kind of comes as a recommendation from us, pastor and deacons. So we don't need to make a motion, and there's no need for a second, since it's coming from a group. Any question before we vote? Anybody? Well, you guys are so easy to get along. All in favor of amending the new Constitution, raise your hand. Any opposed? Our motion carries. Okay, it's as easy as that. Appreciate all that all he did, and the leadership team to put all that together. That was a lot of work, and so it wasn't all that difficult to revise it when the time came. So I'm glad that we got that taken care of.
We have
great leaders. Pardon? Ollie was a great leader. He is a great leader. Ollie's a great guy, so don't give him the big head. He said he's a great leader. Sign all of that at the end of the service. He did a really great job. So a lot of the work was done by all of the Constitution, that's for sure. So, all right, let's have our ushers come forward. We'll receive the offering this morning. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we're so thankful we can gather this morning to worship, and we just pray for anyone here today, Lord, that might have a special need or concern of some kind. Just pray that you'd especially be with them, Lord, and that they might experience an extra portion of your grace today. We pray for those that are struggling, having health problems and other issues, Lord, and just ask that you might encourage each and every one. So, Lord, to help everything go well with our service today, we pray that we feel the presence of your Holy Spirit throughout the service, and that you'd speak to our hearts, Lord, about any decisions we need to make for you. Lord, it's in your name we pray. this morning. He got his whole roll full, look at that. The rest of us need to work on it. Let's all stand and turn around and shake your hands.
With my soul, it is well.
Sheriff, and I've been trying to share a message, apply a message to us, and how that might affect us today and instruct us today. And so this morning, I've got a few pictures of a place called Mount Tabor. Mount Tabor is located way up in the north of Israel, just kind of southwest of the Sea of Galilee. So it's very close to the Sea of Galilee, just probably 5 or 6 miles away. Really a neat place. So the first picture is from a distance. This is from on top of Megiddo. We already talked about Megiddo. That's the Jezreel Valley between Megiddo and the mountains back there. You see right in the middle, at the very back of the picture, a little rounded shaped mountain. That's Mount Tabor. And so the next picture is a little closer view of that. You see how it's kind of round, very unique shape. It's like an upside down bowl or something. It's about 1,300 feet off the surface of the ground there, 1,800 feet above sea level. So it's very unique, and something very, very important happened there. This is where Judge Deborah came with Barak, and they fought against the Canaanites. So we're going to talk about that this morning. So it's really interesting. Next picture, I believe, shows a different view, and you can kind of see in the foreground there, a village. It's an Arab village today, and I believe that may be the village of Deborah, which is probably named after Deborah. And so it's an Arab Muslim village at the foothills of the foot of Mount Tabor. The next picture is from a different view. You can also see the village there, and you can barely see in the picture. You'll get a better view in a minute. On the very top of Mount Tabor is a church, a Catholic church. A basilica. And so it's called the Basilica of the Transfiguration. And so, of course, the Transfiguration is when Jesus was transformed on top of a mountain, the Bible says, and Elijah and Moses appeared with him and discussed some things with him. And Peter, James, and John were there as well. I don't think it happened on Mount Tabor. I think it probably happened on Mount Hermon, which is as far north as you could go in Israel. But probably for tourism reasons, the tourists could access Mount Tabor a whole lot easier, so it kind of became known as the site. And so we'll see a better look of the basilica in a minute. Okay, the next picture shows an aerial view. Isn't that cool? You can see the village there, Deborah, the foothills. And when we get to go on these trips, we go up and get in taxis. They have taxis. And you can see the switchbacks there, kind of on the right side of the hill. You go back and forth to get up to the top of the hill. And so we get in these taxis, and it's quite an enjoyable ride. They're really fast. And so they zip up there. You know, time is money. So they zip up there, and then they zip back down. They get more tourists, and it's kind of fun to go to the top of Mount Tabor. Okay, next picture shows the basilica. It's really a beautiful church on top of the hill. And again, this kind of commemorates the Transfiguration. And so when you go into the church, in the next picture, we'll show a mosaic at the back of the church. Really beautiful. It's made out of stones, and it's just beautiful. And it has Jesus ascending, or being transformed, I should say, not ascending, but being transformed. And on either side of him are Moses and Elijah. Moses representing the law, and Elijah representing the prophets. What's really cool about this, here's a better picture of it. You can tell me that there's a space, a hole in the front of the basilica, so that when the sun is down at a certain time of day, at a certain time of year, the sunlight goes in and shines on that mosaic and kind of illuminates it, you know, make it look like Jesus is being transformed. It's kind of cool. All right, next picture. There's a beautiful garden that the monks take care of. Just a beautiful place to visit, very peaceful. And then I think there's one or two more pictures, maybe just one. There's a picture looking off to the south. And you see that mountain there to the south is called Mount Moriah. And just in the foreground there is the village of Nain. And that's where Jesus brought the widow woman's son back from the dead in that story. So it's an amazing place to visit, a lot of fun. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. And so get into our outline today. We're talking about Mount Tabor, and this is during the time of the judges, before Israel had a king. And so the Bible says everybody just did what they thought was best in their own eyes, but they
didn't have a king, and they didn't have judges, though, that would give them leadership and instruction and help them in time of need. And so, as I think about how this message will apply to us today, what happened and what we're going to look at, I thought about the fact that we all, unfortunately, from time to time, drift into sin, don't we? It's very easy for us to get into a pattern sometimes, straying away from the Lord. And the wonderful thing about being a Christian is you can never lose that relationship. Once you've been born again, once you've been saved, you will never, ever lose your salvation. I was very clear about that. But unfortunately, you can lose fellowship with the Lord. And when we disobey the Lord, and we stray away from Him, and we get into trouble, or for whatever reason, it can happen for any reason, the devil tempts us to do that, of course, we do fall out of fellowship with God sometimes. And so the Lord wants us to get back into fellowship with Him. And one way that happens sometimes is the Lord may kind of take His hand off of us a little bit and kind of let the devil afflict us somewhat. And that kind of disciplines us to bring us back to the Lord. That happens very frequently. This was a pattern of behavior among the Israelites ever since they left Egypt. And, you know, they would get into trouble because they would stray away from the Lord. And God would allow them to be afflicted. Sometimes He would use their enemies to afflict them. They would cry out for help. And the Lord would always be faithful to send them a deliverer, maybe a judge or someone like that, or to rescue them from their troubles. And really, that's kind of illustrative of what happens to us, isn't it? Sometimes we stray away from the Lord a little bit. We go through some hard times. We realize we're not where we need to be spiritually, and we repent of that. We cry out to the Lord, perhaps, and pray and ask for forgiveness, and the Lord kind of restores that fellowship and comes to our rescue and helps us. That happens in my life over and over and over again, and I'm sure it is true for you too. And so here in Judges chapter 4 and verse 1, the Bible says the Israelites once again did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And so they did the same thing. Things might be going well for them, and they kind of began to take their relationship with the Lord for granted. And so they would get into sin, into idolatry, into some kind of evil, and then they would begin to have problems. And so we all have this tendency to sin against God. We have a sinful nature. I wish that would be completely gone when you get saved, but it isn't. It's diminished. The Bible says that when we become a Christian, when we believe in the Lord, that the power of sin is defeated in our lives. And so God will help us to overcome that temptation to sin, but unfortunately it's still there. The Lord still allows us free will. We still get to make our own decisions and choices in life. And sometimes, even as Christians, we make the wrong decisions. And we may stray away from the Lord. Again, we don't lose relationships, but we can break fellowship with God. And so we all have this tendency to follow this same sinful pattern that the Israelites went through. Paul wrote about this in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 7 and verse 15. He said, I don't understand myself at all. For I really want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do the very thing I hate. Can you relate to that?
Yes.
Well, I can. Paul said, I don't know why I do this. And imagine the Apostle Paul saying something like that, as faithful as he was to the Lord. He said, I don't understand myself at all. Even though I love the Lord and I want to serve Him and be close to Him all the time, I consistently find myself straying away from the Lord and getting myself into trouble. And so he said, I don't know why that is, but it's that old simple nature that we have to struggle against every single day. And so this morning I want to talk about how the Lord deals with our disobedience. When we're unfaithful to the Lord, when we disappoint the Lord, when we unfortunately kind of stray away from that fellowship with Him and get ourselves into some trouble, how does the Lord deal with that disobedience? He does it right here with the Israelites, and so we can relate to that and see how He helps us in the same way. The first thing I want to mention is that there are consequences for rejecting the Lord. There are always consequences for our behavior, right? You know, when we do something wrong, when we stray from the Lord, we're going to get into some kind of trouble sooner or later. And so this is what happened to the Israelites. In verses 2 and 3 of Judges 4, it says, because of their disobedience, the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, who was the king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Hazor is a little further north of the Sea of Galilee. And so Jabin is the Canaanite king. And he had a commander of his army whose name was Sisera. And Sisera had 900 iron chariots and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. So for 20 years, they've been dealing with this affliction of Sisera and his iron chariots. Now, up until the time of Solomon, you know, Israelites didn't seem to have any chariots or horses or anything like that. Of course, that's not yet come. David mentioned one time in Scripture that he trusted the Lord instead of horses and chariots and things like that to help him have victory over his enemies. And so at this point in history here, in biblical history, the Israelites are really being afflicted by Sisera because he has 900 iron chariots. So imagine an army of foot soldiers going up against an army with 900 iron chariots. Now, in the scripture here, the passage we're going to study, Israel had, they're going to use about 10,000 soldiers is all. They've got more than that, but that's all that the Lord wants them to use. And they're going to fight against an army that I read had about 40,000 soldiers and 900 iron chariots. So think about the odds. Once again, Israel is greatly outnumbered, and the Canaanites have much more strength and power physically than Israel does, and that's the way God wants it, because God is going to show them how he is going to deliver them, how he's going to help them. And so there are always consequences when we reject the Lord. Sin brings trouble into our lives, doesn't it? When we sin against the Lord, we're going to face some kind of trouble or hardship or problems. Now, do you think we're having some problems and moral issues today in our country? You think we might be having a little bit of that? It's just really getting out of control, isn't it? We really have lost our moral compass as a country. We really have. I remember years ago, I'm old enough to remember, when we had a much stronger Christian impact in our culture. And even among those who were not Christians, you know, the church was so prevalent and so involved and had so much influence in our country that it affected the whole nation. And we really did have, for the most part, a fairly godly nation. There's always been sin, but it's certainly gotten much, much worse in recent years, hasn't it? And so many people now are turning their back against the Lord and turning away from the Scriptures. They're not looking to the Lord for guidance, and they're not worshiping the Lord and giving, you know, praise and glory to the Lord the way that we should as a nation. And so, unfortunately, we've strayed away from God as a country. I'm praying that we can get back to where we need to be, perhaps before the Lord comes back. And so sin certainly brings trouble into our lives. It brings trouble into a nation if that nation turns its back on God. In Genesis 4:7, God told Cain, this is before, right before Cain killed his brother Abel, he said, "If you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it." And so God warned Cain. You know, Cain was jealous of his brother. And he said, Cain, he said, "You're jealous of your brother Abel." Remember, Abel brought the sacrifice that was acceptable to the Lord, and Cain didn't. And so Cain was jealous and angry. And God warned him. He said, "You better get a hold of your temper. You better watch sin, because sin is kind of like a tiger or something. It's just crouching there, ready to pounce on you and to afflict you anytime you're vulnerable." The devil, of course, is behind that. You know, this is the very verse right before Cain took his brother Abel out into the wilderness there and killed him. And he killed his own brother. And so we got to get a grip on sin. We got to resist that. In Hebrews 12:6, the Bible says, "The Lord disciplines those that he loves, and he punishes those that he accepts as his children." You know, Christ is your Savior. You're a child of God. Amen. You're a part of God's family. You've been adopted into God's family. And because God loves you, he will not let you continue in sin before he'll take action of some kind. He'll do something to bring you back where you need to be in fellowship with him. Those of us who are parents, don't we do the same thing with our kids or with our grandkids? Sometimes they have to be disciplined. Sometimes they have to be taught. Sometimes they have to suffer the consequences of their mistakes and their sins because we love them, right? We don't do it because we're excited about punishing our children, right? We do it because it's necessary to bring them back where they need to be on a pathway of righteousness. And so God does the very same thing for us. God is not sitting up there taking delight when we're struggling and looking forward to afflicting us. He doesn't operate that way. God wants us to be happy and joyful and full of life, enjoy everything in the world, and serve Him. But when we do stray from Him, God loves us too much to let us continue in our sin. And He'll take action of some kind to discipline us. So that's what happened here. There are consequences for rejecting the Lord. The Lord let them be oppressed for 20 years by the Canaanites. Second thing we see in this passage is that we should repent of our sins and turn back to God. We should repent of our sins and turn back to the Lord. Notice in verse 3, it says, because he, referring to Sisera, had 900 chariots and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years, notice what they did, the Israelites. They cried to the Lord for help. They cried out to the Lord for help. They said, Lord, we can't take it anymore. It's too much for us to bear. He's got all these iron chariots. He's afflicting us. He's destroying our families. And Lord, we're asking you to please rescue us. Please come to our aid and help us in our time of need. So what does that tell you about us? What's the first thing we should do as Christians when we have trouble? Get on your knees, right? Pray to the Lord. That's the first thing I do. When I got a problem, sometimes it's a small problem, sometimes it's a big problem. When I got a problem, I go to the Lord in prayer. And I ask the Lord to help me, to deliver me. Lord, show me a way to go. And I say, Lord, have I done anything in disobedience to you? Usually I know what I have, right? Please forgive me of that. And please restore that broken fellowship that I've caused. And Lord, please help me to get back on track and to walk with you and to serve you. And Lord, please help me in my time of need. Every Christian should do that. You've got a problem, you need to pray. And ask others to pray for you and with you. And ask the Lord to intervene. And so that's exactly what the Israelites did. Now, we use this word repentance from the Bible. What is it? Repentance is turning away from sin and turning to God. That's what repentance is all about. It's not that you just stop doing what you're doing. That's a big part of it. But you also turn back to the Lord. And you get back on track with Him. And you begin to serve Him the way that He wants you to. And so that's what repentance is all about. So, certainly, there are consequences for disobedience and for sin. God sometimes allows us to suffer those consequences just like He did the Israelites. But when we repent and we cry out to Him and we pray to Him, the Lord will always respond. God is always faithful to respond to us when we call out to Him in time of need. That brings us to the third thing on the back side of your outline there. God will provide for us when we repent. When we sincerely repent of sin and cry out to Him, He's going to respond. That's where Deborah comes on the scene. Judges chapter 4 and verse 4 says, Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lebedev, was leading Israel at that time. Isn't that a cool name, Lebedev? I wanted to name our son Lebedev, but Charlie Levitt. Sister Jill. So Deborah is the wife of Lebedev. It mentions her husband, but the story is all about her. The name Deborah means honeybee. Kind of pretty name, honeybee. And so anyway, Deborah's a very interesting and extraordinary person. And this is one of the places in the Bible where a woman is a great leader among the Israelites. Deborah was a prophet, and she was a judge, and she was also a military leader. That's extraordinary, especially during a time when women were not really known for that at all. And so the Lord shows us how heroic women can be. She's kind of similar to someone like Moses or Samuel, because they also were prophets and judges and leaders, military leaders. So she's right there with them. And so imagine being mentioned so prominently in Scripture as a woman. I look forward to meeting Deborah someday when we all get to heaven. The other women, of course, in the Bible were very heroic and strong and brave. You got folks like Rahab and Ruth and Esther. Certainly the Virgin Mary were very strong women that the Lord used in a very mighty way to bring about His will. So women certainly very, very instrumental in serving the Lord and leading others to serve the Lord. And so God has installed Deborah here as a prophetess. And so everybody would go to her as the judge at that time saying, what should we do? We're in trouble. The Canaanites are afflicting us for 20 years. Sisera's got 900 chariots, iron chariots. We're no match for that army. And so please, please, show us what should we do. They go to this woman of God and say, help us, you know what to do. And so, in verses 6 and 7, she gives them instruction. It says that Deborah sent for Barak, who was the son of Abinadab from Kadesh to Naphtali, and said to him, the Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go and take with you 10,000 men of the tribes of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead the way to Mount Tabor. So Deborah says, sends word to Barak. He lived up in that area. She was down farther south. And she said, you need to go and take 10,000 men from these two tribes to Mount Tabor, and the Lord's going to give you deliverance. She says here that the Lord says, I will lure Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River, and give him into your hands. And so Deborah says, well, I have a word from the Lord. Tells Barak, said, I want you to give 10,000 men for these two tribes up in that area around the Sea of Galilee. Go to Mount Tabor, and the Lord is going to deliver Sisera into your hands. Now, you'd think a military leader of the Jews back then would think, wow, great. I have a word from the Lord's prophet. And so I'm going to do exactly what she tells me to do. I'm going to gather these men, and I'm going to fight this guy. Now keep in mind, she's telling him to just take a certain number here. It's going to be 10,000. And go against an army of 40,000. And they've got 900 iron chariots. And so they're very, very strong. They're going to be greatly outmatched. And so apparently he's a little nervous about that. You ever feel like the Lord really wants you to do something? You feel really strongly about it, but you're scared. You're nervous about it. Say, well, Lord, I can do that. Remember when the Apostle Paul was blinded by the Lord on the way to Damascus, the road to Damascus. And went into town there in Damascus, and God called upon Ananias to go and witness to him. And Ananias said, Lord, have you heard about this guy? He's killing Christians right away. You really want me to go to that guy? He was scared. The same thing happens here with Barak. Look at verses 8 and 9. Barak said to Deborah, he said, if you go with me, I'll go. Now, this is a military command. He said, now, I'll go, but only if you go with me. But if you don't go with me, I won't go. But he's kind of scared. He wants Deborah to go with him. Now, this is a man, a military commander of Israelites, asking a woman, Deborah, to go with him. He says, if you don't go with me, I'm not going to do this, because I'm just scared to death. But he had great faith in the fact that Deborah was a prophet of the Lord. Notice what she says to him. She said, very well, Deborah said, I'll go with you. But because of the way you're going about this, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will hand Sisera over to a woman. She said, okay, you're scared. I'll go with you. I'll be there with you. God's still going to give you victory. But you're not going to get the glory for it. A woman is going to get the glory for it. Now, she's not talking about herself. At first glance, you think, well, she's talking about herself. God's going to get glory then. That's not what she means. We'll see in a moment. That's not what she means at all. But God provides for us. God intervenes on our behalf. And he helps us. He rescues us in time of need, doesn't he? I bet you we could take up the rest of the day if I asked you folks to give testimonies about occasions where God has rescued you in a time of need. If you were struggling, you were afraid, you were hurting in some way, you needed God's help, you prayed, you called out to the Lord, and he delivered you. Well, I can tell you a bunch of my own stories. I bet you every single one of you has stories of how God has done the very same thing for you. Some of you here this very morning, today, you're going through a tough time. You've got a struggle. Maybe it's a big decision you've got to make. and you really need the Lord's help, you need to call out to the Lord. You need to trust in the Lord and rely upon Him and lean upon Him and realize that He loves you and He'll help you in your time of need. Maybe you're going through some consequences because of some bad decisions. And you need to repent of that and say, Lord, I'm sorry, and I turn back to you, and I'm asking for your help. And God is always faithful, isn't He? He's always faithful to help us in our time of need. A very present help in time of need, the Bible says. And so that's exactly what Israelites are going to do here. God provides for us when we repent. The last thing I want to mention here this morning is that God will give us victory when we are obedient to Him. He'll give us victory over our problems. He'll give you the victory. Now, the timing is all about Him, isn't it? We want it right now, don't we, when we got a problem? We don't want to wait for it. We say, Lord, I need it right now. And we're living in a time of microwave ovens and remote control. We don't like to wait on anything, do we? Sometimes the Lord has a reason for making us wait before He acts on our behalf, but He will always respond to us when we call out to Him. So, verse 14 says, Deborah said to Barak, Go, this is the day the Lord has given Sisera in your hands. Has not the Lord gone ahead of you? So Barak went down Mount Tabor, followed by 10,000 men. So he had 10,000 men going against 40,000. And they've all gathered on the town of Mount Tabor. You saw the picture a moment ago with the switchbacks, you know, that were put in later. And now on that point, they were all on top of Mount Tabor. And when the order was given, these 10,000 Israelites came charging down Mount Tabor into the Jezreel Valley to go against Sisera and his 900 chariots and his 40,000. Well, it's been something. Would you like to have been there? I've gone down Mount Tabor many, many times in a taxi. I think it'd be kind of cool to charge down Mount Tabor on foot. Sometimes I'd like to take a group. We'll do that. You know, let's just charge down the hill. You know, of course, it's 1,300 feet down, so it'd be quite a while doing that. But it's exciting to think about what happened in that very place when Barak gave that order, and they all came charging down that hill. I assume Deborah was up there with him. He said, "Where do I go?" She wasn't there. So it must have been quite a sight to see. Now, how is the Lord going to give him victory over overwhelming odds? Verse 15 says, At Barak's advance, the Lord routed Sisera and all his chariots and army by the sword, and Sisera abandoned his chariot and fled on foot. And so when this 10,000 group of men, army of Israelites came charging down that Tabor, God gave them a tremendous victory over their enemy, over Sisera. It says that the Lord himself routed Sisera and all his chariots and the army by the sword. Now, getting to chapter 5, we find out that God calls a rainstorm to come, a great rainstorm. And there's a river down there in the Jezreel Valley called the Kishon River that flowed through there. God calls the Kishon River to overflow its banks. There was a flash flood that came through there and literally washed away all this army and their chariots. They all got stuck in mud. All those iron chariots got stuck in the mud. And they were helpless. They couldn't fight against the Israelites. And God gave them a tremendous victory. Isn't that amazing? God loves to do things like that. He loves to overcome these huge odds that come against us to bring glory to Himself, because all glory goes to Him. Amen? And so that's exactly what He did. So it rained and the chariots got stuck in the mud, and Sisera got out of his chariot and ran away as quick as he could back up toward Hazar up in the north. But in chapter 5, we find out that he was being chased by Barak. Barak's trying to chase him down. And if you remember the story, this is really interesting. Sisera comes up to a tent where a woman is there by the name of Yael. J-A-E-L, Yael. Yael is there in the tent. She's the wife of a man named Heber, who's a Kenite. The Kenites were descendants of Jethro, who was the father-in-law of Moses. Remember that? And a lot of the Kenites kind of intermarried with the Jews. So it's quite possible that Yael may be Jewish. She may not be a Kenite. She's married to a Kenite. She may be Jewish. Now, we're told that her husband kind of made peace with the Canaanites, with Jabin and everything. But apparently, Yael didn't do it. For whatever reason, she didn't care much for the Canaanites, and she sure didn't like Sisera. And I'm kind of wondering if she's not a Jewish woman. If you remember the story, Sisera comes running up to Yael. She comes out of her tent. She says, well, come over here. I'll help you. Come on in. I'll take care of you. And so Sisera goes into her tent. He's exhausted. She gives him some milk to drink, and she says, you just lie down and take it easy. Don't worry about anything. And so he does. And he's so exhausted, he falls fast asleep. And the Bible says that Yael took a hammer and a tent peg, and she put that over his temple, and she drove a tent peg right through his head. How about that? I'll tell you something, guys. If you ever have an angry woman on your hand, don't leave a hammer and a tent peg later in. Isn't that something that God took care of? This woman didn't like him at all. She hated him. And she drove a tent peg. Now the women back then, the Bedouin women, even today, you know, they kind of help pitch those tents, and they're good with those hammers and those tent pegs. They know what they're doing. And she took care of him. And here comes Sisera. I'm sorry, Sisera's got a tent peg, is it? Here comes Barak. Coming up to the tent, he's trying to chase him down, and she comes up, she says, you're looking for somebody? He's right here. Come on in, I'll show you, he's right here. And you see how God gave glory to a woman instead of her. Because it was great. Now they won the battle, praise the Lord. But the one who got the glory really was Yael and Deborah, right? Because they were great. What's that teach us? Unfortunately, we as believers sometimes stray away from the Lord. We get into sin for whatever reason. We need to call out to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I've strayed from you. I know my salvation is secure. I'm never going to lose that. Praise God. But I know I've broken fellowship. Lord, would you please, please restore that broken fellowship. Help me to come back into fellowship with you. Walk with me and protect me and guide me and show me the way to go. And if you do that, you repent. God's going to give you great victory. Amen? Mm-hmm. That's exactly what he did again and again and again and again with the Israelites. And he did it right here. And he used two women to do it. Deborah and Yael. That's a powerful story, isn't it? Aren't you glad that the Lord loves us so much and watches over us and cares for us each and every day? You may be struggling right now, but never give up hope. Never turn away from the Lord. Look to him. Strength that you need to succeed. Amen? Amen. Let's all stand and pray. Lord, it's great that we can be in your house this morning, fellowship together and pray together and study your word, Lord. Just worship you. Thank you for this story of a tremendous event that took place at Mount Tabor. How you gave great, great victory to the Israelites over their enemies. Lord, they were so outmatched. And yet you were faithful once again. You routed Sisera and his army. All those chariots were stuck in the mud because of your power and your grace and your mercy. Lord, I pray for anyone here this morning who may be struggling with sin or struggling to be faithful to you. Or maybe, Lord, it's just a case of kind of straying away from you unintentionally, but it happened. It happens to all of us. Lord, help us to come back home. Help us to come back to you. Help us to be faithful to you once again. And we know you're going to give us a great victory. But in your name we pray. Amen. You need to come this morning. Make a decision. You step out of here.
Holy, 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 Lord.
having. So good to see all of you, several of you that are visiting today. If you've got any questions at all about the church, or maybe you're interested in maybe joining the church or something like anything at all, please let me know. In the bulletin, and also there's some cards, some business cards over there on that table right there. They have my name and email address and phone number. And so if you would, send me a text or an email if you've got a question about anything at all. And I would love to be better acquainted with you and answer those questions if I can. So hopefully we'll do that. So glad you were here this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll be dismissed by the morning. We'll be dismissed.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are excited and pleased to be before you. Lord, let us be very familiar with men, like you were involved in the church.
Help us to come back to you. Help us to be faithful to you, Lord. And we know you're going to give us a great victory. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. You need to come this morning. Make a decision. You step out of there. So glad you were here this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll be dismissed by the morning. We'll be dismissed.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the sight and everything you did for us. Lord, let us be here to come again, like you were.